Fine. So I'm Roberto Maranca. I'm here joined by my good friend from long time, Michele Staiano, from professor at the Department of Industrial Engineering at University of Naples. Myself, I've been in data for a while now, and I've been going around a few, let's say, blue chips. I worked for Nissan, for General Electric, for a Lloyds Banking Group in the UK, and now, since 3 years, I'm doing data excellence for Schneider Electric. It's actually Schneider Electric Global, although I'm, of course, on corporate in the UK. So, Michele, you want to say a couple of things about you?
Just would record it. I'm a co-author, I'm in academia, I'm working for University of Naples in Italy, southern Italy. We are very good friends, so I'm very happy that we have prepared this work, and we are happy to share with you our results.
So, without further ado, what we are talking about today, basically the context in which our paper has been developed is a context of exploitation of data at scale that is happening more and more because of digital transformation. So we basically will start from an understanding our sentiment that we're approaching a complexity tipping point. We're going to discuss that. Why is that? We're going to introduce the generalization of the data supply chains, i.e. the mechanism through which you take data from a certain source, you give data to a consumer of this data, allegedly for achieving some value. We are introducing a concept of the data debt, similar to the technical debt concept. And then we are making some consideration on how we balance this cost versus the cost of introducing creating a data supply chain with the value we're trying to attain. And we're going to get some conclusion. And of course, we'll welcome questions and answers. So, firstly, the context. Why we're talking that is a complexity tipping point? Well, companies have been a journey of digitization, and this journey of digitization is, of course, predicated on data. But what we are seeing in the world, I mean, from a positive point of view, and I'm trying to explain what is going to be more like a positive aspect and more like headwind, if you want. So there is a digitization of processes and products. So that creates a lot of data. There is a sensorization of customer and, I should say, employee interactions. So each one of us is now beaconing data, and companies around data are trying to get this data to do something more from a business point of view. And to do that, companies have been traditionally trying to do everything by themselves, but now they're opening more and more to external collaboration. So there is an expanding ecosystem of collaboration. There are more players coming and helping you. There is more open data shared. That means you are having longer chain of data. There is longer and longer and more convoluted chains of data. And there is because of that, you have a diversification of data sources. Once you are having one system, two systems in which everything was happening, maybe a data warehouse, now you're having a multiplicity of places where the data comes. And again, back from the sensorization, there's tons of time series coming to you. And this is good because that allows us to basically bring our AI and machine learning at scale. We want to have more powered AI powered in companies and organization. And by the way, when I'm going to talk about companies, we are talking about every type of organization. So I will include also the public administration, the charities, and everyone is trying to do something as a corporate or as a entity with data. On the other end, though, there is definitely an increased data regulation burden. There is a lot happening from a regulator from the states trying to understand how we use this data, what is a good usage of data, and are trying to get hold of, you know, and they just have to open a newspaper. They're trying to get hold of this gold or this oil, and data has been defined in many ways, but they're trying to make sure that from a state point of view, that prosperity stays in within their boundaries. At the same time, because of what I was saying in terms of expanding the collaboration, you have a lot more merger and acquisitions. There are more companies are buying more things. Companies becoming more heterogeneous from a makeup point of view, because they want, again, there are traditional companies are not having the skills, are not having the practices to do everything in data. So they want to do that where they want to augment their secret sauce. So they need to necessarily bring people from outside. there is a digitization of workforce, and that's creating complexity because, as you know, in COVID, that has been accelerated x-fold, and that creates complexity, not only in terms of the risks, maybe, but also in the way that we collaborate. So previously, there was a coffee break, and you were talking to your colleagues. Now you're exchanging email. You're needing more workflows that are connecting people. And finally, but not in the least in importance, there are two big aspects. One is there are a lot of expectation out there on corporate to do the right thing and to be transparent. And there is a heightened geopolitical tension that is creating some data protectionisms. All of that is creating an explosion of data supply chains. It's creating an explosion of people trying to get data, using data at speed, at scale. And today, the view we had as authors is the creation, the management, the control of these supply chains of data is very much still an artisan job. It's very much something that is down to the illumination, the intelligence, the ability of certain people. Is not something that is very well coded, very well normalized, standardized. And what that creates is created an interesting, you know, feeding mechanism so that we have more complexity, but you don't have the ability to deal very well with this complexity. So every time you try to do a change, that change is not going to be optimal change. So this bad change will feed complexity. And so this mechanism of feeding complexity is pushing us to this tipping point of complexity where literally the makeup of data supply chains in an organization is becoming something of the typical chaotic system where a flapping of a butterfly wing on a side is going to create a disaster on other side, and it's not going to be something you don't see coming. So now, for all what I said, probably should be clear why we're trying to generalize the supply chains, but there are a couple of other things coming into play. So firstly, absolutely trying to align our nomenclature, align our structure, standardize and formalize to create a benchmark. But second, and most important, vectoring of value, meaning connecting with the value, understanding why we're doing things, what is the value that you're going to extract out of your data. And that is going to have an interesting connecting with lean methodologies and product development methodologies that we're going to get to. But also trying to cut through the tool, what we call the tool-induced fog. There is so many things, so many tools that are happening, that are creating and are continuously onboarded in a company that people are more, they're thinking that there's an app for it. They are more trying to implement the next tool rather than to look at things from a business capability point of view. And so the idea to generalize supply chains is also to move into more of a system agnostic view. Why we're doing this, not what we do this with. Finally, if we are successful in our task, we should be able to create something that is a machine readable structure of a data supply chains. And so we'd unlock a more scalable approach. We can start to think about optimization methodologies to look at the structure of a company from a data supply chains and see and finding insight that is not visible from a human eye point of view. The way we are discussing value is because there is also another important problem in corporation. There is actually almost impossibility of quantifying the quality. So how do I quantify what good data does for me? Now, you don't have the experience, but when you have people coming to a data team like mine and say, hey, I need to do this, the best I can get in terms of a requirement sometimes is an ETL requirement. So move this data from here to there, please, because I need to build a dashboard. But when you ask them what you're going to need it for and what is going to be the value you're going to get, it's very difficult to get an answer. And at best, sometimes you get I'm going to remove the need for a couple of people to build an Excel 2 hours of their time every day. But that kind of benefit doesn't fly with a chief financial officer. That's difficult for us to really make it a quantifiable and concrete business case. So much so that there is another thing that we call like the paradox of the data business case is that when you ask people, how do you want your data? There is only one answer because people don't have the capability to articulate how they want the data. They're going to tell you, either you give me 100% quality or I can't use it. And this is usually a very expensive proposition. So what we're trying to do then, introducing a value-driven data supply chain, is try to break this paradox. And how we do that? So firstly, we looking at the infrastructure. You have the typical, you know, the typical two main points of a supply chain, which is there is a source and there is a target. The source is where the data is in its pristine form, hopefully. The target is where the data is going to be consumed. But we also introduce a classification or a better structuration of what is going to happen from a process point of view. So we're trying to separate what is going to be a process of extraction of data from a process of checking of the quality, from a process of visualization. But most importantly, we introduce the connection to the exploitation. The agent A, so is the data consumer, is the person, or it might be an entity, a machine, because we need to think about the exploitation of data from machines as well in an IoT environment, but is the one that will tell us whether the data is good enough for achieving a value. And is the one is also supposed to give us the mechanism how the value is achieved. So the data consumer, introducing the data consumer in the supply chain with that quality requirement, saying, unless you don't achieve my assumption for good consumption, else I'm not going to consume, it's the key difference from everything has been done so far. So we're trying to bring in this dimension and trying to quantify this dimension in bringing the value for the agent that the requirement from the agent that will generate value. If you put together all those, this equation QIJ with LIJ, basically you're putting together a gap that in the data flow has to be addressed, because the gap that is going to be there is quantifying what is that I need to have the value. And that's where in the quantification for the cost of the data, we basically introduce the concept of data debt. So if you put together all those gaps, in theory, if you have a complete view of all the agents in your company that are trying to consume data out of all your data supply chains, and you sum all those, of course, there's going to be some double counting, but if you sum all of those, this equation, all those gaps, you come up with effectively a quantum that has to be filled with work, because, you know, doing good data, making data good is work, energy, if you want to be more engineering or more scientific. So we can come up with a theoretical amount that can describe what is the level of, you know, bad data that a company as a whole has got. So the value proposition of agents will be achieved if the company invests money to fill those gaps. And the ambition here is really to have this data debt to become a sort of a compass. So today there are methodologies for assessing what is the return on investment of a project, what is the return, the net present value of a project. Our ambition would be to have the data debt to become a third tertiary or the third compass for investment, saying, all right, so if I'm going to do this, how much I need to invest, but at the same time, how much doing this project will resolve in terms of data debt for someone else to come and then being benefiting for the fact that now that place of the company, that data in the company is better. And there is a huge possibility of using this as a benchmark, not only between the areas of the company, but also between different companies in homologous area, and trying to understand whether what is being done at the highest level, at the formalized level, is good or bad. But let's do a practical example. I just want to make sure that we're kept on time. So the practical example says there is a source, there is a CRM, a customer relationship management tool in a company, is the place where you basically onboard all the data that comes from the customer. You try to understand what they're doing. Usually customers are coming to you with a request. The request generates an opportunity for you to sell. And the value that as an agent, imagine I'm the sales director, as an agent, I want to want more opportunities. I want to close more opportunities, meaning that I want to have a handshake and having a contract. So for doing that, I'm going to go to my consumption point, which is my pricing portal, because my strategy is actually to give a certain discount to a certain type of customer, which I've been deciding the company has classified all my customers as in different types. And based on that discount, my view, my strategy, my skills are telling me that I might have more opportunities won. So what I'm gonna focus then is what on my customer, my key data element, my critical data element from the CRM that I want to extract is the customer type. So the customer, I mean, let's imagine that I'm having 1,000 on my records that are all my opportunities that I want to decide the pricing on. And so customer type is going to be the one that as a agent, as a data consumer, I assign my quality level. So I want to have the customer type belonging to type 1 to 10, and that has to be for all the opportunities. Now, when we do the check of what comes out on my CRM tool, I realize that 800 of those opportunities are having something that's between 1 and 10. Maybe, but 200 of them are either missing or maybe is a different value. And so that is easy for us to calculate our data debt, because other data debt will say that I have 200 of my opportunity that I need to be fixed. And let's say in the paper, we've been working for with some assumption with this MU value. The MU value will be basically will give us the quantum of work that can be done, calculated in a very complex way. But we in the paper, we'll find a very, very easy way of calculating using average cost of an employee's average time that is taken for fixing a defect. And that basically makes a nice round number of 6,000 euros. So I know that for me to achieve the benefit, true value from this, my value in winning opportunity, I have already a threshold. So minimum, I need to get 6,000 more out of my one opportunities. Otherwise, the cost benefit analysis doesn't stack up. So this is a way we're trying to create a quantifiable way to connect the value of the company to what's happening in your data supply chain and what is the inherent, you know, quality level of your data. So if we get, then we take this and more from a formulaic approach. So what you're saying, the total cost to deliver then value from a data supply chain will be down to a setup cost, because there is going to be a setup cost. There is creation of those processes. There is, of course, there's going to be some role, some staffing, and there's going to be some servers and whatever. Plus the sum of all data that they are inherent to that data supply chain. Very easy, but of course you can make this very complex and down to how refined that MU becomes, and that MU is very much down to how well you know the innards of your company, how well you know the mechanism that connects things you do in the company with the cost that is the company is, you know, it basically is incurring in doing that. So this is an easy way, it's very scalable, but it still needs a bit of calibration. That's where we're gonna get into the last part of the presentation. So now we're trying to calibrate for data. Calibrate means that, you know, we are trying to move away from that paradoxical, if you don't give me perfect data, I can't do things with it. And that's where we introduce the concept of productization of data. Why? Because data is inherently agile. Agile means that data is something you can treat as with the methodology of the data product, product development. And product development are very established lean methodology, and there is plenty of literacy out there, but the substance is that what we focus as a team is to create a good information product, and that good information product then goes into a visualization. So here I'm doing a bit of a Fordistic sentences where the expectation of people that are coming to data teams is about, can I have a dashboard, can I have a nice report, can I have a nice colors. And in effect, what we're trying to do in Schneider as data teams is to retrench on not on the visualization part, which is basically giving no value, but more on the quality of the data product that goes into that. So you can, as long as you use the right data, we don't care the way that you color it. But the other thing that gives us is giving us a more of a gradual approach or an iterative approach of making data better. And that's because if you imagine the set of all the opportunities in the company, of the set of all the invoices on the company, there are big sets, data sets in company that someone can refine continuously in terms of data. And then what we need just to find is a direction. What we do first, what we fix first. That's where we introduce Kano. Kano, because there are many data requirement or data standard checking, classification or standards out there. There are many framework out there that you can use. But Kano offers us to move this framework, to super classify this framework to the eye of the consumer. Because at the end of the day, you're the owner of a source of data, cannot decide whether data is good or not. Data will always be seen with the eyes of the consumer, of the agent. So Kano gives us, it comes from the quality methodologies and gives us the ability to say, to classify whatever you want to say, if it's completeness, validation, accuracy, limited. There are plenty of naming convention in the data quality methodology or data standard methodologies. But here we're looking really with the eyes of the agent, say there is a must be level. So there are things that you must be, because otherwise I cannot really even start to see through the fog. So I need to reach a minimum level of consumption. Then there is a one-dimensional level, which is going to be basically the more you do it, the more you get it. It's a proportionality there. And then there is the attractive level, which are things that not even the agent knew that were actually good for them. And it's something that's where you really unlock the exception value or the unknown value, the unexpected value, and is a delighter for the consumer. So our formula now changes because the setup cost will be the same, but we can actually, which we can fraction our data depths in three big types, which is the must be, then it is going to be the one dimensional, and then it's going to be the attractive. And if we use a simple graphic visualization, then we start to find interesting things, because here we're having the cost to insight. This is the typical cost to value graph that you will find in many of the marketing methodologies. But here we'll start to see that there is a cost that you sustain at the beginning to set up your infrastructure that basically gives no value from inside. And then when you start to fix your data depth, then bit by bit your value will grow. And the more you know about the chain, the value chain related to data, the cheaper, the flatter would be the curve, the more you can get faster to the moment in which you achieve what in the lean methodology and the product development methodology is called minimum valuable product. The minimum valuable product is the moment in which your must be, now from our point of view, your must be data quality checks are satisfied. So the costs related to the must be, the data debt related to the must be is being prepaid. So your agent start to gain value, start to, hey, actually I see some one opportunity there, because I can see that my strategy of giving discount based on customer type works. And so this is quite key for, because up until now there was no correlation, or it was a very subjective correlation between what is the point at which a minimum valuable product is achieved into data management practices. And so that becomes the critical part of our delivery, our paper connecting this point. But finally, the last point here is going to be around creating a correlation between what is the data maturity of a company. And when I say data maturity of a company, is how this company is doing things, how this organization is good and doing data, putting in place data supply chains, controlling the data supply chains. And from the formula, literally you will see that the better there is your company managing their architecture, managing the demand, managing the delivery, creating a good communication and engagement with people, the lower is going to be their C0 cost, because the faster I can, or the cheaper I'm going to be able to put in place the architecture, I will be able to reuse components of my architecture. I have already maybe a data quality tool that I can use in place. I can basically bring in innovation in robotization of the management of this architecture. And so that will lower my setup cost. But at the same time, to keep my data debt low, I will need to be good, and not only at repaying that, making that going away and reduce fast, but also I'm maintaining that. So in case of a going and basically exploit data where something else, some fix, some data quality management activity was already happening. If I manage to keep that level low, once I fix some data, I fix data for good and not just, I'm not fixing the symptoms, then next time I'm trying to consume, my data debt will be lower. If I have good data security, there's gonna be no pollution, no malicious leakage or destroying basically damaging on my data. So, and if I have a good control environment, I know that whatever is happening is not gonna putting at risk my data. If there is changes, if there are changes happening, those changes are not gonna be adversely affecting my data. And finally, people, literacy, understanding how things are done, behavior that are fostering good care of data will keep my data that low. So this is how we connect the maturity of how a company does things to how low cost will be for us to maintain, to achieve that value. So from a conclusion point of view, and I think I'm pretty on time. So we generalize the supply chains to tackle this complexity point. We want to have a value-driven approach to provide consumer with quantifiable business cases. We want to give them a language and ability for them to substantiate what is the contribution, what is that that this exercise will bring to the company, but also at what cost. We introduce the data debt practically as a concept that is connecting value and cost, and using the quality methodology for Kano, we're trying to accelerate the value creation because we want to focus. We focus on what are the first things, what are the most important things with the eye of the consumer to resolve. I think that's it. Thank you.